"Well, you know the way to a man's heart is through his stomach, Cornelia," explained Captain Jim.
"I believe you, when he has a heart," retorted Miss Cornelia. "I suppose that's why so many women kill themselves cooking, just as poor Amelia Baxter did. She died last Christmas morning, and she said it was the first Christmas since she was married that she didn't have to cook a big 20-plate dinner. It must have been a real pleasant change for her. Well, she's been dead a year, so you'll soon hear of Horace Baxter taking notice."
"I heard he was taking notice already," said Captain Jim, winking at Gilbert. "Wasn't he up to your place one Sunday lately, with his funeral blacks on and a boiled collar?"
"No, he wasn't, and he needn't come neither. I could have had him long ago when he was fresh. I don't want any second-hand goods, believe me. As for Horace Baxter, he was in financial difficulties a year ago last summer, and he prayed to the Lord for help, and when his wife died and he got her life insurance, he said he believed it was the answer to his prayer. Wasn't that like a man?"
"Have you really proof that he said that, Cornelia?"
"I have the Methodist minister's word for it, if you call that proof. Robert Baxter told me the same thing, too, but I admit that isn't evidence. Robert Baxter isn't often known to tell the truth."
"Come, come, Cornelia. I think he generally tells the truth, but he changes his opinion so often it sometimes sounds as if he didn't."
"It sounds like it mighty often, believe me. But trust one man to excuse another. I have no use for Robert Baxter. He turned Methodist just because the Presbyterian choir happened to be singing 'Behold, the Bridegroom Cometh' for a collection piece when him and Margaret walked up the aisle the Sunday after they were married. Served him right for being late. He always insisted the choir did it on purpose to insult him, as if he was of that much importance. But that family always thought they were much bigger potatoes than they really were. His brother Eliphalet imagined the devil was always at his elbow, but I never believed the devil wasted that much time on him."
"I don't know," said Captain Jim thoughtfully. "Eliphalet Baxter lived too much alone. Hadn't even a cat or dog to keep him human. When a man is alone, he's mighty apt to be with the devil, if he ain't with God. He has to choose which company he'll keep, I reckon. If the devil always was at Life Baxter's elbow, it must have been because Life liked to have him there."
"Manlike," said Miss Cornelia, and subsided into silence over a complicated arrangement of tucks, until Captain Jim deliberately stirred her up again by remarking in a casual way,
"I was up to the Methodist church last Sunday morning."
"You'd better have been home reading your Bible," was Miss Cornelia's retort.
"Come now, Cornelia, I can't see any harm in going to the Methodist church when there's no preaching in your own. I've been a Presbyterian for 76 years, and it isn't likely my theology will hoist anchor at this late day."
"It's setting a bad example," said Miss Cornelia grimly.
"Besides," continued wicked Captain Jim, "I wanted to hear some good singing. The Methodists have a good choir, and you can't deny, Cornelia, that the singing in our church is awful since the split in the choir."
"What if the singing isn't good? They're doing their best, and God sees no difference between the voice of a crow and the voice of a nightingale."
"Come, come, Cornelia," said Captain Jim mildly. "I have a better opinion of the Almighty's ear for music than that.